السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والعاقبة للمتقين، ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأولين والآخرين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. ثم أما بعد، all praise be to Allah alone. We praise Him and we seek His help. Whomsoever Allah guides is a truly guided one, and whomsoever Allah leaves astray, no one can show Him guidance. May the best peace and blessings be upon Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Second of all, I would like to extend my gratitude to particularly the organizers and to all of you brothers and sisters. May Allah bless you all. And Allah bears witness that I'm very happy for being amongst you right now. And I'm very happy and proud with the effort that I see in this society from the Muslim group who are living here. May Allah bless your effort. May Allah keep us all steadfast and remain steadfast on the straight path until we meet Him, inshallah. And the topic that we're addressing today is the ideal Muslim family. And this is indeed a topic or a subject which is the most important issue that a male or a female, young or old, a parent or a child is concerned with. And that's why should it be extended over a series of lectures and should be dealt with on a regular basis, not just in 25 minutes, but inshallah we will do our best to focus on what would really help us most to achieve our goal of having an ideal Muslim family. In order to achieve success, you have to look for success both in the Quran and in the Sunnah. We find in the Quran, the Prophet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in a verse approaching the end of Surah Al-Imran. The verse says, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم كل نفس ذائقة الموت وإنما توفون أجوركم يوم القيامة فمن زحزح عن النار وأدخل الجنة فقد فاز وما الحياة الدنيا إلا متاع الغرور. This verse means every soul shall taste death. That's a fact even atheists yield to. And it's only that on the day of judgment you shall receive your wages and compensation on full. So whosoever will be moved away from fire and admitted to heaven, he or she will be the truly successful one. So where does success lie? Success lies in being saved from the torment on the day of judgment, receiving salvation, and making it safely to heaven. This is the ultimate success. Why do we marry? Why do we establish a family? Why do we go to work every day? Why do we send our children to the best schools? Why do we do all of that? These are all important questions which have to be preceded with a proper answer. Not after we achieve the goal. Because sometimes it's too late. You just marry because you saw a girl whom you love, or she's so pretty, or slim, or tall, or blue eyes, or blonde hair, and that's it. No, you have to formulate an intention before every and each act that we do. This is what our deen taught us. If it is a fact that everybody acknowledges, even non-Muslims, non-believers, which is every soul shall taste death. So what would secure our continuation? What will make sure that even though you're dead, you still have roots here that will benefit you after your death? Then we will search in the Sunnah to find a beautiful hadith, that's a sound hadith and collected by Imam Muslim, may Allah have mercy on him. In that hadith, the Prophet, peace be upon him, says, Whenever the servant of Allah dies, all of his good deeds will come to an end. Will come to end except from three sources. One of them is a righteous child. The word walad in Arabic covers both the boy and the girl. Leaving behind a righteous child who will pray for you after your death. I have seen many, many Muslims who migrated from their Muslim lands, whether from Pakistan or India or Egypt or Saudi Arabia. And unfortunately, they achieved their worldly goals. Whether he was an MD or a lawyer or an engineer, they made plenty of wealth. They bought the house. They achieved the American dream in America, for instance. But when you look and investigate their ahwal, their condition in the family, it is very, very unfortunate. Because the family is torn apart. What happened is, in order to achieve the dream, you get the entire package. Your children become exactly like the rest of the society, of the non-Muslim society. They behave like them, they act like them, they speak like them, and they interact with others like them exactly. So where are the Islamic teachings? What have you achieved with regards to your family members? I have only achieved one thing, which is worldly success. Basically, I made money. And this is it. Is this any kind of success? The ayah says by the end, وَمَا الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا إِلَّا مَتَاعُ الْغُرُورِ. The entire worldly life and what it contains is a joy of deception. Some sort of illusion. Basically, if you're happy today, you cannot secure this happiness until the evening, let alone securing it until you die. If you're rich today, it is not guaranteed that you're gonna live and die as rich. If you're healthy today, likewise, so there is always a state of transition. So what one needs to do is to seize the opportunity of his health, of his life, of his wealth, in order to build up an asset that will benefit him in this life and in the hereafter. Let me give you one example of how the righteousness of the family father extends to cover the entire family members. There is one surah which you all recite every Friday. Surah what? Which surah is it? Huh? Was I mistaken when I say you all recite on Friday? Surah Al-Kahf, right? Surah Al-Kahf. In it, there is a story of Moses and Al-Khadr, right? In one of the stages of their trip, they passed by a village. They asked them for water, for food. They denied. They did not give them anything. They were so stingy. So as they were resting, Prophet Musa ﷺ said to Al-Khadr, the righteous man who was inspiring him, give me a hand. He said, what are you going to do? He said, we have to demolish this building and rebuild it again. So Musa ﷺ, the Khadr ordered Musa to do that. So Musa alayhi salam inquired about and said, why? For what reason? Those people are so cheap, they did not even give us water. So why do we have to build anything for them? He said, just help me out and I will explain to you. So when they finished and achieved the construction of the building or the wall, as the Quran says, Al-Khadr explained to Musa alayhi salam why a prophet and a righteous man were utilized as laborers in order to build a wall, reconstruct it. He said, there is a treasure that's buried beneath this wall. And it belongs to orphans. It belongs to orphans, to two orphans. And the wall was about and collapse. You can imagine if the treasure was exposed to such people, stingy people of the village, the very cheap people, they would have devoured it. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent a prophet and a wali in order to rebuild it. But why? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could have saved it by any mean, could send any other person. He said, وَكَانَ أَبُوهُمَا صَالِحًا. Because their father was a righteous man. وَكَانَ أَبُوهُمَا صَالِحًا. It didn't. Their father was rich, and that's why there is a treasure. He did not say because the father was rich. It doesn't really matter whether he was rich or the most knowledgeable person. What mattered is their father was a righteous man. So his righteousness extended to cover his offspring. And for your surprise, the word Abu Huma does not refer directly to the immediate father. It was the seventh great-great-grandfather. So when one is righteous, Allah will protect him and his family. Does that mean we should recline and say, well, alhamdulillah, I'm praying and I'm fasting, I'm going for tabligh and this is it, Allah will take care of my family? That's not fair. That you go out to give da'wah to others and at home is missing you. You're not making any effort in order to maintain the identity and the steadfastness of the iman of your family members. Remember the first call to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to give da'wah to whom? Exactly. وَأَنذِرْ عَشِيرَتَكَ الْأَقْرَبِينَ. Begin with your family. Begin with your family. They're more worthy with your da'wah than anybody else. Why would one extend his da'wah to the outside people and be very active and go for khuruj 3 days and 40 days or whatever, and at home his kids do not even pray? And whenever it's Ramadan, they do not recognize whether it has begun or ended because they don't fast. Why? Why would one give da'wah and teach others outside on Sunday classes while his wife and his children do not even know how to recite a single surah of the Quran? So one has to be fair and balanced and has to begin with his family members because في سورة التحريم in verse number 6, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed a very powerful verse. The verse says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا قُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ وَأَهْلِيكُمْ نَارًا وَقُودُهَا النَّاسُ وَالْحِجَارَةُ عليها ملائكة غلاظ شداد لا يعصون الله ما أمرهم ويفعلون ما يؤمرون. All who believe, قو أنفسكم وأهليكم نارا. You need to protect. Protect who and against what? Protect yourselves and ahlikum, your family members, against what? Against a severe torment in fire. عَلَيْهَا مَلَائِكَةٌ غِلَاظٌ شِدَادٌ. Allah describes a severe torment of fire, but what concerns us here, that the immediate divine command is to protect yourselves and your family members. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took it very serious. And he started going to his daughters and knock on their doors one by one. And he goes to Fatima. Fatima is the leader of women in paradise. He knocks on her door and says, Ya Fatima! Oh Fatima, the daughter of Muhammad. Work and work hard since I cannot avail you an aught against Allah. Not because you are my daughter that you get a green card in heaven. No. You have to prove it yourself that you deserve it. And that's why peace be upon him called on his son. We're running out of battery on this mic. Good, so I can take a drink. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decided to drown the disbelievers at the time of Prophet Nuh alayhi salam, he's been building the ark or the ship for so long. And now the water is gushing forth from everywhere and it's sending from heaven, very heavy flood. So Nuh alayhi salam was worried about one person. That person was his son. He called on him, as the Quran recorded that by saying, يا بني اركب معنا. My son, ride with us, come on board. The son refused because he was not a believer. So he would not be saved simply because his father was even a prophet. He said, nay, I'm going to seek a shelter in a high mountain. I'm going to climb to its peak and I will be saved. The father, Nuh alayhi salam, says to the son, you don't understand. It's not about a flood or a heavy rain. لا عاصم اليوم من أمر الله إلا من رحم. No one will be saved today from Allah's decree except those whom He have mercy on. Your only chance is to come on board with us. But he refused. And all of a sudden, وحال بينهما الموج فكان من المغرقين. So Nuh's son was drowned. When he was drowned, Nuh عليه السلام turned his face towards heaven and he started invoking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He started begging Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, my Lord, my son, he's my son, he's one of my family members, have mercy on him. But since the sin was not just drinking or hanging around with a girlfriend or not praying, none, that the sin was disbelief. So Allah the Almighty said, nay, إنه ليس من أهلك. He's not of your family members anymore. Yes, you had ties in this life. He doesn't belong to you anymore. Can you imagine the Quran over and over tells us that on the day of judgment, يوم يفر المرء من أخيه وأمه وأبيه وصاحبته وبنيه لكل امرئ منهم يومئذ شأن يغنيه. On the day of judgment, everybody would be only concerned about himself or herself, would run away and will denounce his brother, his parents, his own son, his wife. Every person would say, myself, myself, including the prophets, except for one. That is Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Everybody will say, myself, myself. If a person on the day of judgment can offer as a sacrifice his own son in order to be saved so that he can save himself, he would not hesitate to do it. This is the condition on the day of judgment. Today, you're proud of sending your son to a Catholic school because it's a private school, a prestigious school. You get a degree, you get a job and all of that. And they lose their deen. So you're investing in what will waste them. The money is wasted and you wasted your children and you will be asked. In the case of Prophet Nuh alayhi salam, he's not responsible for his son's misguidance because he can only do so much. Jazakallah khair. He can only invest as long as they are under your guardianship. What does it mean? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, and this is a very interesting hadith, كلكم راع وكلكم مسؤول عن رعيته. So what is this hot water for? Is this a tradition too? You take the medicine with hot water? Huh? Zakallahu khair. So every one of you is a guardian. And everyone will be responsible and asked about those who are under his guardianship. The guardianship is not limited to your children, to your wife, children, and even to the maid who's working at home as a domestic helper, because you are the leader. If you have a factory, if you have workers, whatever, you're responsible for them before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because you do have a say. I remember among the interpretation of a beautiful verse of Surah Al-Baqarah, the verse says, ومنهم من يقول ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. Among the smart servants of Allah, those who invoke Allah by saying, our Lord, give us a goodly reward in this life and a goodly reward in the hereafter, and protect us again is the fire of hell. And this is basically the ultimate success, to get the goodness of both, al-dunya and al-akhirah, dunya and the hereafter. Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib's daughter, Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib, is one of the greatest tabi'een, the followers of the companions. His daughter was a scholar as well, and she had finished memorizing and understanding the entire Quran. She said, "Father, there is one verse which I'm confused about. That verse which says, give us hasana in this dunya and a hasana in the hereafter. I understand what is the hasana or the goodly reward of the hereafter. That is definitely paradise. But what about the goodly reward of this life? Which one is it?" So he said, "The goodly reward of this wife, if this life, is to have a good wife. Is to have a good wife." Subhanallah, it is so amazing that Islam is the only religion that tackled every aspect of life, whether related to deen or dunya, to the extent it went with you all the way to answer the call of nature. It taught us how to urinate, how to defecate, and how to clean up afterward. It taught us how to have an intimate relationship with your partner, how to share bed with them, how, all of that. So it did not leave any area without explanation, because Islam is a very comprehensive religion. And since it is the last wahy, then it should be so. It covered everything. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not leave us without guidance as how to have an ideal family. Look, for example, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, "May Allah have mercy on a man who gets up at night to pray." We're talking about the night prayer. Maybe many of us, alhamdulillah, get up at night to pray, but the family is asleep. And in Ramadan, you say, you know, they have school or whatever, so let them sleep, and you go and sleep and pray and so on. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wants us to involve the entire family members in such blessed activity. So he said, "May Allah have mercy on a man who gets up at night to pray. Then he decides to awaken his wife or his spouse. So he asks her, 'Honey, get up, let's go and pray two rak'ahs, night prayer.' She's so sleepy. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, 'May Allah have mercy on him.' He splashes some water on her face in order to awaken her. And he also said, 'May Allah have mercy on a woman who does the same. She wakes up to pray. So she wakes up her husband, and if he doesn't wake up, she splashes some water on his face.'" Basically, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wants the entire family to work together to achieve success. The entire family. And when I say to splash some water, please do not misinterpret me. Because once there was an incident where the Sheikh was talking about the practice of a Muslim when you see a bad dream. When you see a bad dream, what are you supposed to do? Some people said spit. Some people said, If you ever eat a heavy meal, spicy one, then you go to sleep and you see bad dreams or a nightmare, what are you supposed to do? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Turn to your left side, turn to your left side, and itfil thalathan." Itfil means to blow without saliva, without mucus. So you do this, okay? And you say, "A'udhu billahi minash shaitan ar-rajim." So one of the sisters was attending a halqa and heard this hadith. And luckily, or unluckily, she have seen a bad dream. And immediately she turned to the left side where her husband was asleep. And she started showering him with mucus and saliva. He woke up and he was so scared. What's wrong? Are you okay?" She said, "This is what the Sheikh said." Sheikh didn't say spit on your husband. And the hadith says, splash some water, so you wet your fingers and you do like this.
You do not bring a bucket of water and you drown her. They said, this is what the sheikh said. The Egyptian said. Now, the Egyptian sheikh didn't say that. The hadith doesn't say that. The hadith is talking about cooperation in helping one another to achieve what's good and what's righteous. وَتَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى. So you awaken her, or she wakes you up, and you both pray even two rak'ahs. What is the significance of that? Significance of that is, don't you be selfish. Don't try to save yourself. Involve your spouse with you in your dreams, in your goals. And very interesting story that it is worthy of mention in this occasion is that many, many times I get this question, especially from the sisters. Whom would a woman or a wife marry in heaven if she had multiple husbands in this life? And if a woman was married and her husband expired or divorced her, particularly if he died and she was widowed, then she married another person. And he too was righteous and he died. Then she married another person. I would advise her not to marry again. If that happened, and they were all righteous people, and she too was a righteous person, so on the day of judgment, they all made it to heaven. We understand that in heaven, if I was married, I would marry my wife in heaven as well, right? So the question is, whom would this woman marry in heaven? The first, the second, or the latest husband? So the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in one hadith, who knows first before I answer? Who knows the answer? The latest. المرأة لآخر أزواجها في الجنة. The woman would marry her latest husband in dunya, would marry him in heaven. So if she was married to several before, once they died, and she marries again, the relationship has been discontinued forever because now she's married somebody else. So listen to this very interesting story. There was a companion by the name Abu Darda, may Allah be pleased with him, and his wife. They loved each other so much that once they discussed together the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Al-mar'atu li-akhiri azwajiha fil jannah." Al-mar'atu li-akhiri azwajiha fil jannah. A woman would marry her latest husband in dunya, she would marry him in heaven. So they made a deal that even if Abu Darda dies, that she will never marry afterward in order to be his wife in heaven as well. This is a sound incident, story. So Abu Darda eventually died before her, and she lived a long time afterward, to the extent that during the Khilafah of Muawiyah, and he was the leader of the believers, Amir al-Mu'mineen, the Khalifa, he proposed to her. She was a great companion. So he asked for her hand. Look at the interesting reply. She sent back to him saying that مِثْلُكَ لَا يُرَدْ. Such proposal should not be refused or turned down. You're a noble person. But I have promised Abu Darda to be his wife in heaven. To be his wife in heaven. I wanted to remain with him in heaven. So what we need to do is, if you love your spouse, if you love your children, if you love your offspring, you gotta know how to give them a hand. How to take them with you to paradise. How to shelter them from the torment and the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this life and in the hereafter. I don't really care if you die leaving behind tons of money, but leaving no deen. They don't know how to pray. They do not know of their deen, nothing. I met somebody whom we invited to the masjid, and I realized that he was born in Islam. He was born in Islam. So gradually we gave him da'wah, and him and his family and his brother and his sister, they all started coming to the masjid. So later on, I said, since you started practicing the deen, have you ever thought to perform in hajj? Now we are at the age of 50. He said, you know, Sheikh, that was not even in my wildest dream to think one day of going for Hajj. I thought this is odd, but now I'm ready to go. I want to tell you one thing. I was born and raised in a house that its door opened to the door of the masjid. I heard the adhan 5 times a day until I grew up and I still traveling to the states and migrating. I never set a foot in the masjid. I never set a foot in the masjid. For 40 years, I never knew as when did Ramadan begin or when did it end. I was only aware of Christmas and Halloween and Thanksgiving and Independence Day and 4th of July and all of that. Other than that, nothing. There are many, many cases like that, brothers and sisters. Because the concerns and the priority is the dunya, the degree, wealth, and its position. While it has become certain for us through experiment that it doesn't last. Nor does it benefit, unless if the person is righteous and pious. Only if the child is righteous. In the hadith of Muslim, he said, "A waladin salihin yad'u lah," or a righteous child, not any child, a righteous child. Because every time he makes sujood, I remember that it was my dad who taught me the Quran. It was my dad who accompanied me to the masjid. It was my dad who taught me this and this and that. I pray for him. I pray for my grandfather. Every time I remember why. If I recite the Quran beautifully, it was my grandfather who taught me. If I do anything properly, it was my parents. So I pray for them. One religious scholar at the time of his death was crying badly. My father-in-law witnessed this. And he asked him, they asked him, "Why are you crying? Would you please pay close attention to this? Why are you crying? Are you afraid of death? Alhamdulillah, you're a righteous man. You memorized the Quran and you've done a lot of good things." He said, "No, by Allah, I'm not afraid of death for myself. I just feel sorry that who is going to pray for my dad after my death? He's dying and he's concerned about one thing, that whenever he was alive, he was constantly making dua for his father. So he was worried that when I die, who's gonna make dua? Not for me." He was worried about continuously making dua for his father. This concern doesn't come out of the blue. Doesn't happen all of a sudden. It only happens because the family father was concerned about pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he made the right choice with regards to choosing his life mate. Similarly, the girl made the right choice with regards to choosing her final selection and choosing her life mate in the dunya and in the jannah, inshaAllah azza jal. When they decided to have children, they knew exactly this is indeed the best investment. The best investment. Not because I'm a doctor, I would like my son to inherit the clinic. Or because I'm practicing in any kind of trade or business, I want my children to inherit the wealth and continue the... No! These are all dunya things which will definitely come as long as you're working for it. And by Allah's decree, you would only get what He decided for you. But for the deen, it must be your effort. You must work hard for it. You must invest in your wife, in your children, and everyone who's under your guardianship. In order to be ideal, it is not sufficient to be righteous by yourself. So I teach my children, I teach my family members, I teach my viewers and audience the following. Alhamdulillah wa shukrillah, we all give in a charity, right? If we enter any Islamic center here or there, I know that a dollar or two is very insignificant, but you have to chip in. Play a role or a part. And it will be best if you have your youngsters with you, and you make sure that they're so short because they're very tiny and young. So you give that dollar to your son or daughter, say, "Son, put this here in order to grow very big. You're gonna collect it on the day of judgment as big as a mountain of good deeds." This is how you inspire them. This is how you inspire them. The chances of growing righteous children in a righteous family are so great versus when the person is selfish. And he's practicing the deen by himself, but at home, he's afraid to teach his children to be religious because of the society, because of the media, because of the environment, because of the school, because we live in a non-Muslim country, then you're so weak. You're so weak. Last but not the least, because I ran out of time, when I was in North Carolina, I noticed that it's a beautiful state, North Carolina. I noticed that it is very green and trees are all over and forest. And my observation was concerning one thing. All the trees were straight like a ruler, to the extent that when they chop them off, they just sharpen them and they use them as power poles. They're so straight, like you molded them. I was always wondering, how come that the trees are so straight? They're so huge, 20, 30 meters, and the tree is very straight. There's no crookedness in it. You can barely see any. Until I came to realize that the baby trees that they plant, the baby trees, and pay attention to this, they plant, when they plant a tree like that, they hook it up to four supports from four angles until it grows up strong and can stand on its own. That's why I said, you know what? That's why the trees are straight. Versus when we plant a tree, we do not really care whether it grows right or left or crooked as long as there is a tree. It's a very simple effort, very simple effort. But it produces a very fine result, a beautiful figure. So if you want to have an ideal family, you do not say it's too early to speak about it, or it's too early to tell my wife about hijab or my daughter or to teach my son the Quran. If it is too early, then it is too late. One person went to a scholar and said, my wife is expected, and I just wanted to know what are the Islamic etiquette with regards to raising children in Islam. He said, it's too late. He said, she did not deliver yet. He said, in order to achieve this goal, that has to begin prior to marriage. Prior to marriage. This is the last advice to those who just go for the first pick without paying attention to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has guided us to with regards to making your choice in respect of your life mate. أسأل الله العظيم رب العرش العظيم أن يهدينا إلى صراطه المستقيم. الدعاء, brothers and sisters, is the most powerful mean for guidance, for maintaining our deen and steadfastness, for maintaining an ideal family, because our effort could be in vain if we're not being assisted by Allah's help. And that's why by the end of Surah Al-Furqan, the criterion, there is a beautiful dua that Allah taught us and He praised. Let's pray this dua and we'll learn its meaning. رَبَّنَا هَبْ لَنَا مِنْ أَزْوَاجِنَا وَذُرِّيَّاتِنَا قُرَّةَ أَعْيُنًا وَجْعَلْنَا لِلْمُتَّقِينَ إِمَامًا. Amen. It means, our Lord, grant us from our spouses and offspring comfort for our eyes and make us leaders of the righteous ones. رَبَّنَا هَبْ لَنَا مِنْ أَزْوَاجِنَا وَذُرِّيَّاتِنَا قُرَّةَ أَعْيُنٍ وَجْعَلْنَا لِلْمُتَّقِينَ إِمَامًا. Another beautiful dua. رَبِّ جَعَلْنِي مُقِيمَ الصَّلَاةِ. Look at the dua of Ibrahim alayhi salam. He said, oh Allah, make me among those who establish the prayer. And this is not it. He said, وَمِنْ ذُرِّيَّتِي. And also my offspring. And my offspring. Ibrahim and Ismail alayhi salam, alayhim as-salam, when they finished the construction of the Kaaba, now they made dua. They said, رَبَّنَا وَجْعَلْنَا مُسْلِمَيْنِ لَكَ وَمِنْ ذُرِّيَّتِنَا أُمَّةً مُسْلِمَةً لَكَ وَأَرِنَا مَنَاسِكَنَا وَتُبْ عَلَيْنَا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ التَّوَّابُ الرَّحِيمُ. You guys want to know why are we here right now? It was the blessing of the dua of Ibrahim and Ismail alayhi salam. They invoked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make from among their offspring a believing nation. We are the fruit of this da'wah. So pray for yourselves, pray for your family members, your spouses, and your children with guidance. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ وَصَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَى سَيِّدِنَا مُحَمَّدٍ وَعَلَى آلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ وَسَلَّمُ.